It's 3:05. I think we should start.
Yeah.
Can we?
Yeah.
Okay. So to start, I'm really very happy to welcome all of you to today's lecture. And many of you know that this is the third lecture in our series, which are organized to commemorate 40 years of CWDS. We are happy that many of you have been joining our lecture series, and I'm really grateful to all of you for your support. Today, in fact, we have a very special invitee who is a performing Bharatanatyam dancer. Since yesterday, I was quite worried because of the cyclone and the rains there. We were wondering whether we will be able to do it today or whether we have to reschedule it to another date. Anyway, I'm very relieved to have this talk organized today, because she has in the morning itself has conveyed that the rains have subsided and the communications are all in place. So we could go ahead with the lecture. So to introduce Nritya Pillai is not only a dancer, she is also a dance composer, singer, dance instructor, and a scholar who writes and speak on dance, and who proudly claims her Natuvana Devadasi lineage. Following the legacy of her maternal grandfather, Swami Malai Rajaratnam Pillai, she has been consciously preserving and reanimating the rich repertoire and the teaching and choreographic practices of her celebrated ancestors, Meenakshi Sundaram Pillai, T.K. Swaminatha Pillai, and Padmasri Vazhuvoor B. Ramayya Pillai. Carving out her own space as a performer with impeccable training and vast creativity, Nritya represents a new kind of artistic and intellectual engagement with the troubled history of Bharatanatyam. She has challenged the power relationships and ideologies that make this form of dance unavailable to women of her community, and advocates fiercely for the restoration of credit for Bharatanatyam technique, repertoire, and philosophy to the hereditary community of practitioners. Nritya's voice, raised against casteism in the contemporary dance world, is unique in the field today, and her message against historical misrepresentation is relevant and powerful. The topic of today's lecture is, can there be a progressive feminist Bharatanatyam? Class, caste, and representation. We are really very happy to have you, Nritya, to speak to us on this occasion. Before I request Nritya to speak, the usual announcements. Please keep the audio muted when Nritya is speaking. After the lecture, which will be for 40 to 50 minutes, we will have an open discussion. I request all the participants to put their comments, their questions in the chat, in the space for chat. And you could also unmute and ask questions after the talk. The lecture is live telecasted as before on YouTube, and it's also being recorded, and it will be made available on YouTube later. I look forward to a good discussion, and now over to Nritya.
Thank you, Neeta, for the wonderful introduction. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. It's a rainy afternoon here in Chennai, and I'm glad all of you are joining me here, taking the time out and joining me today in this talk. I am Nritya Pillai, and I'm thankful to CWDS for reaching out to me to have this important conversation at this juncture. I think both are very crucial, the conversation and the juncture. We have been at this crucial juncture to critically analyze everything that has been handed down to us, histories, beliefs, notions of culture, morality, and entertainment. All of these have been affected by the intersections of caste, gender, and privilege. This is the reason why these fears are exclusivist in nature. Only a select few who have the right kind of intersections have been able to make it. My talk will simply question the notions of what is classical, who performs it, where it is performed and why it is performed the way it is performed. I would also take this opportunity to thank Professor Devesh Soniji for all the conversations that we have that inspires me to articulate my own thoughts better while supporting it better, supporting it with data from his research and knowledge. And I also thank Dr. Vidya Natarajan and Professor Hari Krishnan. Neetaji gave a wonderful introduction for me. While all that is true, I identify myself as someone who's asking for and making interventions. Interventions in what is Bharatanatyam, what its critical history is in terms of its problematic past, and the continuing nature of what was sown in the past that has led to the structural caste and class-based exclusion within the art form. While there is certainly tokenism and lip service in terms of showing the presence of others within the dance fraternity, it won't be untrue to say that it is Brahmanic power and Brahmanic taste networks that drive all facets of Bharatanatyam. The dance form in cities like Chennai and its critical history in major universities abroad, barring a select few who exercise both sensitivity and caution with the subject, especially with respect to interventions made by voices like mine. I think I need to make a very crucial point before I begin. I would like to make my stance with respect to the term Devadasi clear. I think one among my many interventions has been pointing out the instability of the term Devadasi. I have said time and time again that I find the use of this term very problematic. And yet there is a lobby that seems to keep insisting that we uphold this term in public discourse. Their justification rests either on arguments about indigeneity, for Devadasi is after all a Sanskrit term, never mind that it was hardly ever used in the historical record before European colonialism, or it rests on the fact that a certain generation of rural women from my community used this term as an inheritance of social reform, much in the same way that they would tell you that the ritual of Bottukattudal or initiation was a good thing of the past. My decision as someone of a different generation and social location to identify with the English term hereditary dance community or courtesan caste in order to build solidarities with young women from similar Bahujan communities across India, such as Kolati, Tawaif, is critiqued by upper caste gatekeepers as foreign, a term that has different cultural connotations. Such gatekeepers want to keep this identity, the identity of the Devadasi, trapped in the cage of the archaic, so that they may emerge as the legitimate modern face of Devadasi dance and discourse. I would like to question as to what purpose the restoration and the use of the pejorative colonial category Devadasi does, and to whose benefit? What about women outside the generation who self-identify using this inherited term and truly want to move beyond stigma? How many educated young women from this community want to claim this label? I certainly don't. Only upper caste Brahmin women and white women want to use the term Devadasi to claim or claim to do Devadasi dance, a relatively new phenomenon which I will be speaking about later. While they continue to romanticize this practice and its repercussions, for women within these castes. Some such women even put up pictures of their own staged Bottukattudal or other bygone initiation rituals. And only they can claim to be a Devadasi or dance sadhar without having to face repercussions. First, there are very few young women from my caste location who are dancing Bharatanatyam, and none of them identify or can be identified with this term Devadasi. The reform to criminalize the practice and my foremothers happened nearly 100 years ago. Of course, there are older women who inherited the term Devadasi through the reform about 150 years ago, like I said before, and continued to use it. Women from these generations are very scarce at this point in time. But the term is irrelevant now for young women. It is triggering and creates acute intergenerational trauma. for people in Kotasan communities connected to histories of music and dance. I want to be clear that the usage of the term and its attendant narrative by upper caste women undeniably inflicts violence and actually dissuades women from engaging in both the dance form and its critical history. And then I'm asked, okay, so show me where are the girls from your community today who want to learn this art and say they are from this community? Which young woman wants to intentionally re-inscribe stigma-laden names like Devadasi onto herself? And for whose benefit? Ultimately, this issue brings into sharp relief how acts of naming and logophobia are modalities of power in caste society. So while I will be using this inherited term Devadasi, which was thrust upon my community in the context of history, I will be exercising caution too. It is also important to reflect about its problematic nature, especially with respect to the present realities of women from formerly Kotasan castes. The present issues of caste, class, gender, all of them are driven by histories of cultural nationalism that led to the reinvention and reimagination of what is today called Bharatanatyam. Our unquestioning acceptance of the supposed heroes and victims of this narrative have almost never, with a few scholarly exceptions, been critically examined through the lens of justice and equality. Today, I'm going to venture into the realm of issues related to caste, class, and gender in Bharatanatyam, focusing on how present-day issues must be critically related to the dance's 20th century past. I begin with the caste problem. I think I would like to say that it is impossible to divorce upper caste stewardship of the arts, Bharatanatyam in this case, from the larger history of Brahmins and civic power in colonial Madras. Brahmins have wielded disproportionate amounts of power in the life of the modern city. First, under the aegis of British government, they were read as the indigenous intelligentsia of South India and placed in positions of civic power. This is a complex process that, of course, has an even older history. And the work of ethnohistorians like C.J. Fuller and Nick Dirks has explored this in great detail. The linking of Brahminic civic power to the arts in Madras really happens in the early decades of the 20th century. The following is the common historical narrative about dance, and it's a problematic one. Bharatanatyam is the reinvented format of Sadar. Sadar was exclusively practiced by Devadasis in Tamil Nadu, especially around Tanjavur region, since time immemorial. Revivalists such as Rukmini Arundel and E. Krishna Iyer, and upper caste cultural icons like K. Subramaniam, Dr. V. Raghavan, and reformists like Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy played an important role in whatever happened to Bharatanatyam. And essentially what happened is the democratization of the art form. It is proclaimed that what was essentially an inheritance of a few immoral courtesan castes was opened up to people from all caste and class locations, and therefore lent respectability to both the art and its performers. So I mentioned that this was a problematic rhetoric, and there are so many problems when we accept this narrative uncritically. First, the reinvention history cannot be separated from the politics of the present, nor for that matter can the politics of Devadasi reform. Reform and reinvention were continuous processes, even though many scholars seem to want to read these as two very unrelated issues. And traces of both these braided processes live in our present. I think we now need to begin to rewrite histories of the reinvention that explicitly account for the caste and casteist exclusion. There is still a powerful lobby that insists that the reinvention at the hands of figures like Rukmini Arundel or E. Krishna Iyer was not at all casteist, and their visions for the future of Bharatanatyam were somehow about social equity, or as people in Chennai often say, the democratization of the arts. In popular parlance, this period is unfortunately celebrated using problematic celebratory language such as revival and renaissance, without asking the question of for whom was it a revival versus for whom was it a loss. Because we don't have a ton of time today, I will just focus a bit on E. Krishna Iyer, who once described himself as the chief architect of the renaissance of Indian dance. So quickly, for those who don't know, Krishna Iyer was born in Tirunelveli district and studied law and practiced as a lawyer at the Madras High Court until 1943. Music and theater were amateur interests of his. And in the 1930s, he joined Pammal Samanda Mudaliar's drama company, Suguna Vilasa Sabha. And in 1939, he acted in a Tamil film. Incidentally, those famous pictures of him dressed as a female dancer are not some kind of protest he staged by dressing up as a Devadasi to prove the validity of the dance to a suspicious public, as we hear in dominant anecdotal histories. But all of these photos of him are either from the drama staged by Suguna Vilasa Sabha, in which he largely acted in female roles, or from the film Keechakavadam, in which he performed the role of Brahannala of the Mahabharata. As the work of Hari Krishnan in his book Celluloid Classicism has shown, the pieces he performed both in the theater and the Tillana that he performed in the film were pieces based on the technique he learned from one of my ancestors, Madhurantakam Jagadambal. Around roughly the same time that Muthulakshmi Reddy presented her Devadasi Abolition Bill to the Madras Legislative Assembly in 1927, a group of upper caste nationalists in Madras adopted what they called a sympathetic view to the arts. In other words, while these cultural nationalists agreed with the reformers that courtesan lifestyles had to be criminalized at all costs, they felt Devadasis embodied precious music and dance practices that needed to be grafted onto respectable women's bodies. And these transformed arts were to be deployed as the heritage of the nation. To this end, the Madras Music Academy, an almost exclusively Brahmin organization established by the Indian National Congress in 1928, began to host a series of performances by women from these courtesan backgrounds. These performances, held at the very height of the abolition, Devadasi abolition movement, cannot be read as an instance of well-intentioned public patronage of hereditary female artists, as they are usually represented in dominant histories of Bharatanatyam. In a letter addressed to Muthulakshmi Reddy in The Hindu newspaper in 1932, E. Krishna Iyer, then secretary of Music Academy, explains, this is a quote, "For my part, it is no question of art at the expense of morality or even positive encouragement of the present day notch girls as a class, and never a justification for the perpetuation of the Devadasi class as such. The heavens would not fall and morality would in no way be jeopardized if one or two cases of very good art is reluctantly tolerated in exceptional instances without the associated vice as a matter of temporary evil necessary pending the coming up of better persons." In other words, the public display of the dance of hereditary performers at the Music Academy was a temporary evil. It was meant to jumpstart a process by which upper caste elites could practice and steward these arts in the future. Years later, in 1948, in an essay entitled Renaissance of Indian Dance and Its Architects, E. Krishna Iyer makes it clear that an intentional program of appropriation and social engineering was at work on the part of upper caste cultural nationalists through the work of Music Academy. With all these, Bharatanatyam was still in the hands of exponents of the old professional class. This is again a quote. With all these, Bharatanatyam was still in the hands of exponents of the old professional class, with all its possible and lurking dangers as pointed out by social reformers. The efforts of the present writer were turned towards steadily taking it out of their hands and introducing it among cultured family women of respectable classes. We must add that terms like respectable family women and better persons are certainly to be read as markers of socio-economic status. But in this case, the term respectable classes is also a marker of caste. It is the antithesis of the term dancing girl class that was used in the abolition debates between 1927 and 29. A term that Krishna Iyer himself used in his letter to Muthulakshmi Reddy. In much of the nationalist discourse, as a number of historians have demonstrated, the English word class was a muted reference to caste. And Krishna Iyer's words make the transference of knowledge project stand out as an undeniably engineered one. And yet there are those who refuse to acknowledge the fact of appropriation, even though it is so clearly and unabashedly stated here. This is, of course, because of the re-scripting of dance history, and it was done at the very hands of individuals like Krishna Iyer. And subsequent generations of India's dance historians followed. Most of these later dance scholars were deeply entrenched in the project of cultural nationalism and were connected, often politically and personally, to government agencies such as the Sangeet Natak Academy, the Ministry of Culture and others. The situation continues till this day. Projects of dance history writing in India, therefore, for decades after reinvention, served the nation and created a standard, uncritical and easily reproducible narrative about the reinvention. In all this, the issue of caste was intentionally rendered invisible. Not only were music and dance recast in terms of Brahmanic, symbolic and technical language, but were also repopulated by upper caste elites. This gave rise to an entirely new cultural economy that enabled the circuitous global flows of an embodied idea of India's classical heritage. I think there are so many details around caste that flow through the reinvention, and these are yet to be written about. And of course, let's not forget that the same holds true for the music history, and we are lucky that slightly more progressive movements have been made on that front. Another related but important point has to do with the idea of aspirational Brahmanism and tokenism in the arts. It would be ridiculous to assert that Brahmanic stewardship implies that only upper castes participate in the arts today. But to have one Dalit performer, two Muslim performers, three Christian performers, four non-Indian or multiracial performers, or five Isai Velalar or hereditary performers become the mouthpieces of aspirational Brahmanism and ventriloquize the same old script of cultural nationalism will not affect real change. This kind of tokenism has been in effect since the 1940s through the rhetoric of the so-called democratization of the arts that was supposed to have been the end goal of the unity in diversity model of cultural nationalism of the mid-20th century. These token representations of diversity do not challenge the basic structures of power, the cultural spaces, critiques, pedagogy, scholarly representation, institutions that are still undoubtedly Brahmanic and work to keep Brahmins at the center. I would like to talk about a new phenomenon, which again is a repercussion of Brahmanic power that has gripped the dance world since the mid-1990s. Namely that of Brahmin women dressing up as Devadasis and claiming to somehow represent hereditary past in this manner. I would like to think of this as having analogs with the phenomenon of blackface, in which for centuries, African people have been impersonated by non-black bodies in a process that only gives the impersonating non-black performer power and control over the real black body. What is interesting here is that Brahmin women claim to do this in order to create awareness about something that has lost, that has been lost, as a kind of cultural nostalgia about a bygone age of Devadasi dance and music repertoire. I think one of the problems in this power matrix is the discipleship that these women claim under older women from the community, from the Devadasi community, from whom they receive such repertoire, as if this somehow gives them an intimacy around representation, something they believe trumps the caste-based power they're exercising in their relationships with such figures. Incidentally, even the older women from whom this repertoire is received do not represent themselves or dress themselves in the manner Brahmin women do. This clearly establishes how this is about playing dress-up, using this notion of cultural nostalgia and not the present-day realities of women in this community. Disturbingly, these Brahmin women who want to acquire the Devadasi's art in the 21st century, repeating the old cycle of appropriation once again. But in a world where social justice has come front and center, they try to claim that their project is one of recuperation and equity and speak in a language of Brahminic neoliberalism. They do this while they use their power to delegitimize voices like mine, deciding selectively who the real subaltern voice, or in their own terms, who the real Devadasi can be. Ultimately, these projects are only about maintaining totalizing control over representation of the discourse on Devadasis. Such acts can never enable young women from the community at any level, and this is actually its very intention. We must also remember that for an older generation of women from my community in rural South India, the critical discourse is not important, but patronage is. These women, like the women of the 1930s, such as Karikal Sarada, who tried to teach for a while at Kalakshetra, still see the urban dance scenes as a realm of fiscal opportunity and Brahminic patronage as the key into that world. Moreover, from the standpoint of rural women, the ongoing fiscal patronage translates into other kinds of loyalties, including the public defense of such acts of appropriation. If necessary, who can blame them? Caste-based patronage enables economies of competitive social mobility. This is why criticality, politics, and intersectional feminism are important. I think what we see with many of these dress-up dancers and the patronage of individual women from this community is essentially a rehashing of the politics of the reinvention, but cloaked in a neoliberal discourse that makes them feel better about the fact that this is all still ultimately an ongoing act of appropriation. Their projects are ultimately about their own self-fashioning as fully armed and enabled transnational Brahmin representations, representatives of Devadasi past, taking Sadr to London, for example, even as they decry the work of some transnational academics and uncritically embrace those who provide transnational patronage. This does absolutely nothing to change the balance of power or the politics of representation. And this is the long-standing and unchecked power that Brahmin women have held in the world of Bharatanatyam, something that many outsiders have critiqued for decades now, but something that continues amplified today by the prominence of anti-Western sentiments fueled by Hindutva. In all this, what I want to emphasize is that Brahmin dancers going into rural South India, excavating individuals, holding them up as gurus, and then taking their dress-up dance to the West is clearly not the solution, certainly not how we can create equity. Such projects uphold Brahminic power structures by making the Brahmin woman's body the locus of not the reinvented Bharatanatyam that we saw from the 1950s to the 90s, but now the locus of the art of the disenfranchised. This is totalizing appropriation. Even as they now claim to represent the Devadasi through their Brahminic bodies, they actually take up space in which it might have been earlier possible for a young woman like me from this community to represent herself. And I more than anyone understand this, since it is something I have experienced directly. The main reason for this is the persistence of an almost feudal patron-client relationship these women seek out with older women or men from the Devadasi community, cloaked in the saccharine sweetness of the phrase Guru Sishya Parampara, where the non-Brahmin guru is unknowingly the client and the Brahmin woman Sishya is actually the patron. This is what needs to end, in my opinion, for herein lies the insidious nature of caste-based power as both fiscal and representational control. This was a summary of what I feel are the caste-based problems that are persisting in this field, in the dance fraternity, in Bharatanatyam. And I move on to the class problem. Often class and caste are used interchangeably. Upper caste elites refuse to use the word caste. It probably helps them feel more delusional about its existence and less accountable for their privilege, much like E. Krishna Iyer and his quotes. Many elite and yet serious practitioners of this art form have, for some time now, been admitting to the class problem in Bharatanatyam, that the art form is expensive, the jewelry, the kanjivarams, the stitching of costumes, the arangetram or the debut performance, all are elaborate and expensive affairs, they admit. Most importantly, they emphasize that the art form does not offer enough to secure a livelihood, that one cannot sustain being a performer without coming from wealth. I would like to reiterate again that we very well know that class and caste are tightly enmeshed in our society. It is privilege when you can segregate class and caste. It is privilege at work when Bharatanatyam's gatekeepers consist of a group of extremely wealthy and powerful elites who decide the taste, habits, and the rules of admission into this old club. There have been negotiations lately by practitioners today, these days, to cut costs and to liberate the art form from the clutches of elitism. But these negotiations do not address the root problem, which is the caste-based power imbalance. This, of course, ties into a much larger current discussion around so-called wokeness or Savarna cultural progressiveness, which still ultimately will not cede cultural space to Bahujan women. The money in Bharatanatyam is from government-sponsored performances, awards, and in factory-style mass-produced teaching and arangetrams. And it is quite clear that it is social capital that helps one fulfill their artistic pursuits. There needs to be admitted that this condition is mostly an effect of the reinvention of Bharatanatyam as a spiritual pursuit for the respectable classes. The question therefore boils down to the patronage to the art. Who is the patron? Who is patronized? With additional questions, favoritism, caste and class-based network politics. When Brahmin elites wanted to replace the bodies that performed the art form, they were never meant to be the bodies of Dalits, Bahujans, and other marginal individuals. And therefore, there continues to be conflict when individuals from marginalized backgrounds, especially those questioning the status quo, want to dance Bharatanatyam. And I say especially those questioning the status quo with some emphasis here. Sometimes men and women from the traditional community who are in desperate need of upper caste patronage get co-opted the upper caste nationalist narrative in order to carve out marginal livelihoods and careers for themselves in a world that remains dominated by Brahmins. Those of us who remain non-conformists and present resistance to such ongoing acts of Brahminic dominance are thrown out of the insular world of dance patronage, while the conforming hereditary artists are held up as a handful of exemplary figures who prove that the world of Bharatanatyam is a supposedly non-casteist space. All of this ultimately works to uphold the hegemonic ownership of Bharatanatyam and its representation by upper caste, and is tied into the questions of economy. I finally come to the gender problem. Intimately connected to the project of cultural nationalism is the imposition of Hindu neo-conservatism in Bharatanatyam, with heteronormativity at its very heart. Take, for example, the idea of the male dancer of Bharatanatyam, created in this matrix in the 1930s. The present gendered aesthetics began after the reinvention, dictated in large part by notions of maleness and femaleness that came from a range of sources for figures like Rukmini Arundel. On the one hand, there was the Brahminic masculinity that is echoed in Sanskritic texts that the reinvention valorized, and there was also the gendered language of Theosophy's notion of the world mother and the idea of the domestic woman that it promoted. In Kalakshetra, men were taught a certain kind of dance, hands on the waist in a certain manner, change in the repertoire, and more geometry and more masculinity, often with the sacred thread to be worn prominently by Brahmins and non-Brahmins alike as a badge of cultural honor. Kathakali asans were consulted on how to transform this courtesan dance based on themes of love and eros into a radically masculine nationalist symbol of Hindu past. This example alone illuminates the intertwined nature of caste, class, and heteronormativity that have come to define the form and its symbolic world. This history has led to the silence about sexuality of the performers of this art form. Until recently, there was never a space for queerness. Part of this denial comes from what scholars have called the allegorical spin given to the dance, that is, the feminine Jivatma and the masculine Paramatma, neo-Vedantic ideas that again were overlaid onto the dance during the reinvention by Theosophists and other elites. Such overlays actually hide the narrative and performance of sexuality that is at the center of all forms of dance involving the human body, not just Bharatanatyam. Having said this, it is also interesting that gender is one of those arenas where things have shifted slightly, but still problematically, since the time of the reinvention. In the transnational and mostly Savarna Bharatanatyam world today, being queer is not such a debilitating factor. In some circles, it's cool to be a gay male Bharatanatyam dancer who performs nationalist, upper caste religious narratives. In other words, sexual orientation trumps the problem of caste. The establishment is willing to allow a queer body into spaces as it conforms before it allows a non-savarna, non-conforming body. In these privileged circles, being queer isn't a debilitating factor anymore, but lack of privilege through caste and class still is. We also have a few transgender women dancers, but I often wonder about how a queer woman would engage with this art form. Where is the space for such representation, and why do we not see it? This is why conversations about intersections of caste, class, and gender and sexuality are important. We need to see how certain elements of this equation are privileged over the others in certain moments. How true equity can only be reached when this kind of power play comes to an end. So now that I've spoken about all the caste, class, and gender problems, I think about a conclusion as to how do we counter these individual and institutionalized forms of caste-based power, shaming, appropriation, and claims of ownership. Certainly, a change in both the historical discourse of Bharatanatyam and its practice is necessary today. We need to come up with ways of foregrounding the invented nature of the 20th century discourse and replacing it with real social histories of dance practice. This is a challenge for all practitioners of Bharatanatyam, whether they are conscious of it or not. Whether they deny it or not, they are all implicated in this problematic history every time they lay claim to this dance or tie the bells on their feet. But another major reparation has to do with who gets to speak for Bharatanatyam. I come from these erased histories. I represent the remnants of what the state and Brahminic power tried to erase. To my mind, my very presence, my body, my aesthetics, and my reclamation of who I am questions and muddles this clean history of Bharatanatyam. Other women like me, I hope, will also come forward to understand and reclaim our place in these muddled and yet perhaps generative paths. I will be finishing, and I'm going to leave you with a few visuals of my performance, which perhaps is a representation of these erased histories. Bodily representations of these erased histories. And after the clip is played, we can have questions.
Sorry, Nritya, I think Sundaresh is trying to put it.
We tried playing it before this when we had a trial and it worked.
Yes, it did. So I'm waiting for him to do it.
Okay, okay. But I can answer questions till then too, if somebody has questions.
There's one question already in the chat box, but let us see it.
Okay, here's the video. Yeah. I think the audio is not... audio
Sundaresh, can we get the audio on? This seems there is some problem. Sundaresh,
abhi try kar raha hu.
The video is not there.
Abhi kar raha hu.
Okay.
Late from the very beginning now.
Okay, just a minute.
Tunga di kutunga ta kudi kutum ta tei tei dani tum ta dingina tum ta di kuku je ta tum ta ta di tunga di kutunga ta kudi kutum ta tei ta.
Thank you, Nritya, for a very powerful articulation of class, caste, and gender concerns.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
So it's open for discussion now. So there is already one question, three questions in the chat box.
Mm-hmm.
No, that is two are about not
having
not working. So there's one question about the independence movement.
Mm-hmm.
And on the developments then, especially by
Ms. I'm supposing the question is, what is the role of the independence movement on the developments, especially by Ms. Rukmini Devi, who was active in the independence movement? I mentioned that the Madras Music Academy was initiated by the Congress, by the Indian National Congress. So clearly, the political movement and the nationalism that was happening during the independence completely drove the narrative of the reform, in fact, the Devadasi reform, because we clearly know the reform was taken up by Muthulakshmi Reddy, and she was part of, at different points in time, different parties, but very much a political person. So every political leader at that point in time was associated with this politics of the reform or the abolition of the practice. And therefore, the idea of grafting this art form from these immoral courtesans onto the respectable women was also supported by the political movement at that point in time. So independence movement played a very important role. We would also be hearing a lot of these anecdotal historical moments where Gandhiji refused to take money from women from these communities for the Swaraj movement. So we have many cases where these women have been treated differently by the leaders who were speaking about equity and justice and independence. Yeah. Yes, Mohanji.
I'm reminded of Muthulakshmi Reddy's contribution to the debates on bringing down maternal mortality rates.
Mm-hmm.
And, she headed a committee which wanted to... she was also a leader of the movement, in a sense, to rescue childbirth from dies,
mm-hmm.
to medicalize it. Anyway, but my questions related to your talk. Thank you very much. I enjoyed them very much.
Thank you.
I'd like you to tell me, during this process of invention of this tradition of Bharatanatyam, mm-hmm. were there corresponding changes in the text of the music accompanying the dance? Mm-hmm. Were there also changes in the repertoire?
Absolutely, there was changes in the repertoire and the whole ascription of the dance form to the Natya Shastra or to Brahminic texts would obviously change the content of this dance form. And that did happen. But also there is the case where existent repertoire was cleansed, or the claim of cleansing existent repertoire or dancing in a certain manner to the existing repertoire. But because today we still have dancers performing to the Tanjore Quartet Varnams and Javalis and Padams, but somehow it is okay for them to be dancing it. So this idea of removal of eroticism of sanitizing the art form was projected and put forward. And I sometimes wonder, as somebody from the hereditary community, I always wonder as to what has been sexualized. Because all along, women from the community danced in saris, in complete saris. But today we have dancers dancing in costumes, which sometimes are revealing. And so which is sexual? Who decides what is sexual? So it is definitely, the whole aesthetics of the dance form has changed. But to claim that the dance of his hereditary dancer was erotic, and today's dance is not erotic, or today's dance is a cleansed version, is somehow very problematic.
Thank you.
Can you go through the questions, Nitya, or should I read it for you?
I can go through it.
There are many questions. There is a question about about your performance and asking what is the difference between your performance and that of upper elite caste men or women?
Okay, so I have been trying to consciously speak about the history while I dance. So I take repertoire that actually speaks of the historical aspect of this art form. So all of those pieces that you saw that I performed were from backgrounds of court traditions or temple traditions. The first piece I performed was from performed inside a temple. And many of those pieces are based on a repertoire that is coming from a historical perspective. I also believe that this besides the fact that I am talking about the historical nature, the historical problematic history of Bharatanatyam as I dance, I am also somebody from the 21st century and a woman who believes in equity and justice and feminism. So I think that is also something that I focus on while I dance. So while I dance, even though there is the trope of religion or Hindu gods in it, I focus on the erotic nature and the feelings of love and eroticism that was actually the focus of the dance form when it was performed by my people. So these are the things that I focus on. And I must say that there might be problems with respect to having a feminist Bharatanatyam, even when you consider all of these things. So it is a constant process of updation where you keep trying to make it less problematic. And that's what I try to do.
There's a question on the music, I think, which is like the language. Question about performances in Sanskrit and some in Tamil. So whether there are any other languages. And why is it that all songs are most of the songs are about Hindu gods?
We cannot deny the fact that this art form was practiced within temples and courts. And therefore, the religious significance is there. But there is also a secular nature to this art form, because while we as people moved from place to place. So this idea that Bharatanatyam is from Tamil Nadu is itself problematic, because we have dancers and Natuvanars being part of the courts in Trivandrum, in Mysore. All of these courts have had women from these communities. And to ascribe it to a particular geography is very problematic. But when we moved from court to court, we also imbibed the culture of people from that part of the geography. And therefore, the music and the dance was to cater to the audience at that point, at that place. So we have several pieces that are written on kings in different courts. So I think this was the original content of the dance form. Whereas today we've made it more about bhakti or devotional, aspects. And even with the concept of devotion, how it is portrayed today is very different from how it was portrayed in the past, in families like ours. I clearly remember that my grandfather never had these long stories or sancharis, as they call it in dance language, long depictions of the stories of mythology, were never part of our dance form. We often concentrated on the now, or how we felt at the moment, and this whole idea of emoting without planning. So there was it wasn't a planned performance most of the time. Manodharma, or to stand on stage and create something at that point in time was very much a part of abhinaya or expressions. Should I look into other questions?
There's a question on Brahminical appropriation and its impact on the rapportier and the margam.
Mm-hmm. That brings a radical... There has been a rising movement trend among Savarna feminists, Savarna liberal dancers, that brings in radical contemporary works as markers of protest, performing to Faiz's poetry, etc. How do you see this movement, particularly when it's accompanied at the same time by a non-critical examining of dance history, of the dancer's own Savarna position? I think this is a very important question, and these are things that I keep calling out. I think it's very important to first critically examine the dance history before they rise issues of other issues through this dance form, which is already problematic in its nature. I must add that I have performed to Faiz's poetry, and but I believe that, I wouldn't say that it is wrong to be doing any of these things. I just wish that it was accompanied by some kind of critical mindset about the history and some acknowledgement of their own privilege and position.
The question about whether there could be something which could be called a truly democratic art. And how can privileged practitioners of classical art forms work on rewriting problematic traditions and spotlight marginalized communities and identities?
I often think that, even for me as a dancer from a marginalized class location, I have constant struggles with dealing with this art form. For me, in my case, it's also a very personal struggle where this art form has been denied to my ancestors. So I haven't had women in my community dancing, in my family dancing, for the last 5 generations. We have been continuously restricted to being women at home, or home housebound women. So this access to the art form is somewhat new, and it's something that I have actually forcibly taken into my hands without the consent of my family. So I have a very, problematic struggle with dealing with this art form. And even then, I consider myself as a privileged practitioner from the marginalized caste. So I often wonder if I am doing justice by speaking about it, because I have numerous women from this community who are probably not equipped to speak, to articulate, or to even understand the politics of this art form. So this constant struggle of acknowledging your privilege and yet trying to do something about the problematic nature of this art form is something that we all have to deal with in different quantities. And I believe the first step to that is the acknowledgement and reflection, after which something can be done about it. And it is a process that each of us need to think about. These days, I think some dancers are reading a public acknowledgement.
You've got cut off.
Yeah, I think there's some connectivity issue. Nitya, are you back?
I am.
In between, there was a problem.
Am I back?
Yes, you are.
Okay. I don't know. Something's wrong with my system, I guess. But I can't see the screen, but I can answer the question.
So that's fine. I will read it for you, the chat, the questions.
Okay. So I was saying, so this whole dealing with one's privilege and continuously trying to deal with the problematic art form is something that everybody has to deal with and everybody has to do. And it's a process that all of us have to somehow manipulate and negotiate with. And in recent times, I've seen some of these dancers reading out public acknowledgements where they talk about how the hereditary dancing community has been socially and politically challenged in the 19th century, and after which this dance form has been it's come from them. So I think this kind of acknowledgement can be a starting point for major change. But I also believe that each of the practitioners need to do their own kind of dealing with this problematic past. And I think some of them are doing it. And I'm glad that I'm enabling these things by speaking out.
So there's a question as to how do you see the contribution of Kapila Vatsyayan?
I haven't read much of Kapila Vatsyayan, but I have always been somebody for whom my lived experience has mattered a lot. And I feel that there hasn't been enough acknowledgement of the lived experiences of hereditary performers, or even the voices that were raised in the past. That's what I would like to say.
So there's a question, basically it says, what are the strategies you think to include this critical history in dance performance and pedagogy?
I think the most important thing is that, there is not going to be a way where critical history is going to be included by the practitioners of today, because they clearly don't want it there. If somebody wants you to believe that it comes from the Natya Shastra, I've seen many, many, many performances where even performances that are from the national institution where they claim that this comes from the Natya Shastra without any accreditation to the hereditary performers who taught the art form at those very institutions at the very beginning of those institutions. So these are narratives that can never be included into the larger perspective of what commercial Bharatanatyam is today. And it's important that each of us do our own reading. I mean, I think when you get into a performing art form, it's important to do a critical study of the history of the dance form. And I think That's the only way that one can actually gain some awareness. But I'm hoping that in the future, many people who start noticing this problem, this problematic past, will slowly acknowledge it and include history and include a new history, the new and more correct history to this art form as a part of their pedagogy.
So I'll read this comment from Radhika Mule. She writes, thank you so much for the session. I acknowledge that I come from upper caste family and I also understand the problems of appropriation, which you mentioned so well. As a student of dance, I'm trying to understand where do I fit in the discourse? How do I make sure that I am careful about not carrying forward this problematic narrative of caste, class, and gender inequality? I do love the form and it has been a very central part of my life, like how it is yours. So she basically wants to know how should she be careful.
I think some of those things that I mentioned before should actually be, I mean, in the talk should be acknowledged. And, you know, if you include those narratives in your narrative of dance and probably teach about the history or talk about the history and talk about appropriation, acknowledge the appropriation, and perhaps those things can come a long way. And like I said, this dealing with this problematic dance form, each of us have to do it in our own ways. For me, this is how I feel that I can deal with this problematic history, by talking about it and by rising up and showing myself as somebody who can actually muddle the history that's propagated by others.
So there's a question on the secular content of Bharatanatyam. Are there any secular content of the Bharatanatyam repertory that survived the appropriation? Also, any idea if Kalavans in Western India practiced Bharatanatyam?
Are they talking about Kalavantulus?
Kalavans, it is written Kalavants.
So Kalavantulus are from Andhra East Godavari district, and they are very closely related to the Isaivelalars of Tamil Nadu. This is why I feel that the geography is very problematic to quote that Bharatanatyam is an art form from Tamil Nadu and it's the classical dance form from Tamil Nadu is quite outside the truth, because this form has been part of South Indian courts, and women from East Godavari district, these communities are known as Kalavantulus. They also practiced a version of this art form. So the entire corpus of South Indian dancing from the South actually contributed to what today is Bharatanatyam. Kalavantulus are also performers of this art. And as for the secular nature of the repertoire in the past, I would like to say that the Padams and Javalis, many of them are about love and eros. So I think love is a universal emotion and therefore secular. I also believe that this was a caste-based occupation for many women, and it did lead to a certain kind of disenfranchisement and marginalization and oppression. So we cannot untie this art form from the religion or from the religious aspect or the caste aspect in the past, but we can constantly try to do so in the present.
So there's a question about gods and goddesses and how, were gods and goddesses represented in the earliest forms of Bharatanatyam? And was there a change in these with the Sanskritization you have described? What would you call it, a Sanskritization in fact?
I would definitely call it Sanskritization. Yes, we did prayers and This, like I mentioned time and time again, it is an art form from the temples and the courts. So there is a religious aspect to it. And of course there was, some amount of devotional aspect in this, but not the way that it is today. I mean, this whole idea of a upper caste Hindu, Hindu-ness is what I think I'm trying to question when I say that, you know, there were many, many Bahujan practices, like, you know, this art form is a Bahujan art form from a Bahujan community. So, the devotion that's represented today in terms of dancing to Carnatic music numbers, to Tyagaraja's kritis, or to Muthuswami Dikshita's kritis, were never part of the dance form in its past. So these are definitely newer aspects, or even dancing to shlokas, or these were never part of the historical version of the dance form. So, yeah.
I think we are over with the questions in the chat box. Okay, one more is there.
Okay.
If I am not wrong, Kulavans are a different community from Kulavanthulus of East Godavari. The Kulavans are a community from Goa with a history of hereditary practice and music, of music and dance, often referred to as Nachnis or Khanis of Goa.
Okay. I mean, every geographic region had a courtesan tradition, I'm sure. I was talking about the Kalavanthulus of East Godavari district, and they definitely were part of, I mean, this is the whole problem when we want to, the history acknowledges the Natyashastra, which was excavated in Kashmir and has no connectivity to something that was practiced in the south of India. But we don't want to acknowledge the Kalavanthulus who exist kind of close by to us. So so Kalavanthulus are from East Godavari district, and they definitely have practiced very similar temple and court traditions.
So there are no more chats now.
Okay.
So it's open to now participants to unmute and ask questions if they want to ask directly to you. Are there questions? Please unmute and please ask.
I'm Uma from Hyderabad. I teach at IFLU. I thank you so much for your talk. I've been hearing about your work. I was quite excited to see that there was a talk scheduled, and I've learned quite a bit from your talk. One question I had was, what I found interesting was this idea that with the nationalization of Bharatanatyam, there was a sanitization of it, that the more erotic aspects were muted, if not completely erased, and a more spiritual thing was put forward. But then what I found interesting, what you said today about the fact that so was the eroticism, you know, you sort of problematized that idea as well, which I thought was interesting. So I'm thinking, if we are looking at, so while we acknowledge the way in which it was spiritualized and nationalized and appropriated by upper caste groups, today, as you said, a contemporary dancer in the 21st century, where it is being performed on stage, or maybe now today virtually on the internet, or it finds a place in new spaces, basically. So it's no longer in the temple, it's no longer in the court. So it's no longer performed for a deity or for a rich patron or a rasika of the old kind. So in that sense, obviously there will be a change in its aesthetics and So how are you, on the one hand, is your project a recovery of the pre-reform dance, or is it an attempt to create an entirely new dance language within this genre? How do you look at it?
I think it's an important question again. And I believe that recovery cannot be possible because we have come through all these phases of change. And this whole idea that suddenly today I can somehow recover this older form and start dancing while ancestors have contributed to what today is Bharatanatyam also. So how can I claim the old when the new is also, new also has the contribution of my ancestors? So I think this whole idea of the old and new is problematic. My idea is to have an alternate aesthetic. My idea is to have an aesthetic that perhaps will embody the erasures that have been consciously and institutionally erased from what today is Bharatanatyam. So, and I believe it is a very organic process. I dance. In fact, I believe that there are very few dancers who are dark complexioned, a very, very few dancers who have a body structure like mine. So I think just my existence as a dancer questions a lot of these norms and these rules about how a dancer should be, or I think these are again extensions of caste-based notions of what a dancer should look like, what a dancer should be dancing, what a dancer should be wearing. So all of these, I think my mere existence is questioning. So that's what I believe in. And I don't believe in recovery. I don't believe that today, a lot of people ask me if I dance Sadhir. And I recently had a conversation with a hereditary dancer who's called Muthukannamal, who's in her late 80s. And she performs Sadhir, and she calls her art Sadhir. And she asked me, so what do you perform? So I said, I perform Bharatanatyam. But my great-grandfather, Varur Ramya Pillai, taught Bharatanatyam. My grandfather taught Bharatanatyam. So how can I perform Sadhir? So this notion of recovery is again something only Brahmins can do, or only upper caste women can do. And they can become people who recovered art forms and then get acknowledged for recovery. So that's not my project at all. I don't believe in recovery. I just believe in a more just dance fraternity or a dance form that is acknowledging of its past, that's acknowledging of all those political changes, social and political changes that it went through. And it's also inclusive in terms of having people from many different caste and class locations as part of it. And in the true sense.
Thank you so much. That's so interesting what you said about the difficulty, or really the impossibility of recovery. I think that's a very good starting point for conversations like this. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
There are two more in the chat box now.
Okay.
One is the question as to whether you have ever been invited to perform at the Music Academy. And the second is, how do you see Bala Saraswati?
Okay. No, I haven't been asked to dance at the Music Academy. I have applied a few times and I haven't been asked. And as for Bala Saraswati, Bala Maho, obviously she is an icon for many of us. I think she would be the one person who stood her ground and, succeeded. But again, I find it a little problematic that we always want to focus on those success stories when numerous women were erased. I want to focus on those erased women who were erased, women whose contributions were not acknowledged. So those are the women that I want to look up to. those are the women who I want to speak about.
So, more questions from the participants. Please unmute and ask. I think we are done. There are no more questions. Yes. So, thank you, Nritya. It was
thank a very you, thank you so much. Thank you for
the discussion. So, thank you all. Thank you all the participants for attending the conversation. And hopefully, we will meet for the next talk. I invite all of you to the next talk also. Now, it will be in late December. Thank you.
And what is it? Why don't you tell us, Nita?
It is actually the title is not, topic is not at final. It will be on disability.
And who's speaking?
Janet Price. The dates are yet to be confirmed, so I am not announcing it. I don't know when it will be, but end of December.
Anyway, this has been a wonderful lecture, so we hope that the rest will also be able to live up to this.
Thank you, Rajni ji.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.